Welcome, everybody, to the fifth Academy 4 research webinar on mental retardation and protein dynamics. Today, we have two speakers, Dr. Carole Guizdek from IPMC and Dr. Frédéric Casals from INRIA, both in Sofia Antipolis. Now, we have the Dr. Frédéric Casals, who is a research director in INRIA in Sofia Antipolis. Dr. Casals leads the algorithm biology structure team INRIA Sofia Antipolis. He teaches computer sciences at Université Côte d'Azur and applied mathematics at Centrale Supélec. His research is at the interface between computer sciences and structural bioinformatics. He is the architect of the structural bioinformatics library, which proposes a novel synergy between low-level algorithmics and structural bioinformatics. The title of his talk is Mining Protein Flexibility, a New Class of Move Sets. This is a joint work with Timothy O'Donnell, who is a PhD student in his lab.
I'm not going in this talk to solve the problem Carole talked about, namely the prediction of the 3D NLS of fMRP based on the structure of its enter domain. So we are not there yet, even though we are trying to move along this direction. Yeah, and so to make a long story short, we are trying to deform, to change the conformations of the backbone of proteins, and of course also side chains, but I'll be focusing on the backbone in order to provide moves which are like, you know, the tails of Perrault, the seven leagues boot, les bottes de sept lieues en français. Because if you're familiar with modeling, in fact, people who are running molecular dynamics, they are using tiny time steps, namely femtoseconds. And of course, when they are moving the atoms around, this is ending up in tiny moves. In other words, two conformations of molecules which are consecutive a long time, they are essentially the same, right? Tiny movements. And so here the goal is to try to design movesets which are really huge, meaning that in between two conformations, we'll have a very significant movements of the atoms. This is what I have illustrated here on this top right figure, where, as you can see, we have how many? Seven conformations of, in fact, three peptides. And as you can see, the individual atoms are moving by several angstroms, four or five, typically. And so the bottom right figure is, in fact, a set of different conformations for so-called CDRs, complementarity determining regions of antibodies. You know that these are the loops which are typically contacting the antigen. And so as you can see here, we have also generated highly diverse sets of conformations. So this is what I'm going to talk about. So I guess as biologists, you are completely familiar with, in fact, the movements of flexible regions in proteins. And so here I picked three examples corresponding to the figures. So the first one is about CDRs again. As you know, on a typical antibody, we have two domains. Two variable domains, one from the heavy chain, one from the light chain. And so we have six flexible loops on each such domain. And so overall we have, let's say, 6 × 15, a bit less amino acids. And so everything at the interface between the antigen and the antibody is accounted for by these flexible regions, which are really, in general, flexible. Another example, which is completely different, is that of ACRB. So this has been a joint project with Isabelle Musbeto from IPNC. And so ACRB is in fact a membrane protein in bacteria, which is involved in the efflux of, antibacterial drugs. And so this is like a peristaltic pump. It's a homotrimer, three copies of the same polypeptide chain. And so it's really complex. And so of the order of 15 flexible loops, which explain the complex relative movements of essentially rigid domains. And so if we want to understand how a monomer switches from, in fact, a conformation A, which is access for the ligand, to conformation B, which is bound, and then to conformation E, which is exit, we have to, in fact, study the flexibility of these many loops which are connecting the rigid domain. So this is another example where protein function is tightly coupled to flexibility. And of course, the last one, as the last example, I picked the case of IDPs, intrinsically disordered proteins, and more generally that of highly flexible proteins such as the fMRP enter-domain Carol talked about. And so in all these cases, in fact, we need to predict either the structure or the thermodynamics, for example, the binding affinity between a protein and its partner. And so for now, from the computational standpoint, these are open questions because, you know, in fact, predicting these conformational changes and calculating the thermodynamic quantities or possibly the kinetic constants, in fact, this amounts to doing a very high dimensional integral. Keep in mind that if we have n atoms, each atom has three Cartesian coordinates. And so if you have 1,000 atoms, you have to deal with 3,000 XYZ coordinates. So we are dealing with high dimensional problems. And so in order to talk about the geometric models, let me recall that in general, when we are modeling molecules, we are dealing with a mix of models. One part is modeled in Cartesian coordinates, namely for each atom X, Y, and Z. But it's more convenient to work with, for several questions, and I'll be doing this in this talk, it's more convenient to work with so-called internal coordinates. And so here, we are talking about the bond length between two atoms sharing a chemical bond, the valence angle between three atoms which form a triangle, and the last type of internal coordinate is the so-called dihedral angle, namely if you have four consecutive atoms, so the first three define a plane, and the dihedral angle is in fact the angle between this plane and the plane defined by the last three atoms, right? And so using dihedral angles, we can model the backbone of the protein. And so I'm sure you are familiar with the so-called Ramachandran diagram. If you pick a C-alpha carbon in a protein, the two dihedral angles which are found apart from the C-alpha carbon are the so-called phi and psi angles. And if you collect all these angles into a protein conformation, and if you perform a 2D plot of these two angles, you end up with the Ramachandran diagram. So we'll see a few of them on the next slide. And of course, we have the same kind of model to model, in fact, the side chains of proteins with dihedral angles. And so the Ramachandran diagram is a fundamental plot which was discovered almost 60 years back by three Indian scientists, Ramachandran, Ramakrishnan, and I don't remember the last one. And this is what a typical plot resembles, looks like on this upper left plot. As you can see, the color coding here corresponds to the population. So when it's white, there are no such angles. By the way, again, so the two axes, phi and psi, corresponds to the two dihedral angles, which are before and after a C alpha carbon. And again, if we collect all such pairs for a given polypeptide chain, and if we plot all these points in the plane, we end up with this diagram. And as you can see, we have some empty regions, namely those which are white or light yellow, and we have some highly populated regions, in particular red or black. And so in fact, if you're familiar with this, we have in highly populated regions our alpha helices, the right helices, right-handed or left-handed helices. We also have the beta sheets, and we also have a region corresponding to beta proline secondary structures. And what is interesting is in fact the distribution of these regions, but also their geometry. As you can see, we have this ellipsoid like regions which are essentially empty. And in fact, it turns out that the geometry of the Ramachandran diagram is encoded by the relative distance of four heavy atoms, which are the oxygen of the carbonyl, the C beta atom when there is one, namely for all amino acids except the glycine, and then the O of the carbonyl and a nitrogen here. And so if we are exploiting the relative distances of these four atoms, we can describe, in fact, the geometry of the region in the Ramachandran diagram. So it also shows that if you want to propose a plausible conformation of a polypeptide chain, in fact, you'd better avoid these regions which are empty, because again, this contradicts the physics. In particular, in putting conformations in such regions, one would end up with very high van der Waals interaction energy, in fact, energies that would be prohibitive, meaning that the associated conformations are very unlikely as given by Boltzmann factor in a so-called NVT thermodynamic ensemble. And so now let me bridge the gap between Ramakanthan diagrams and tripeptides. In fact, a tripeptide, this is just a set of three consecutive amino acids. And so if you look at this middle plot here, let me try to magnify a little bit. So as you can see, we have three amino acids, the first one, the second one, and the third one. And we're going to assume here that we're going to play a game, which is the following one. You can deform the geometry of a tripeptide by changing the dihedral angles, but without altering the bond length and the valence angles. So in fact, it's the reason why I've put this ellipsis along the chemical bonds, meaning that you can, in fact, if you were to roll such a segment within your finger, your two fingers, in fact, you would change a dihedral angle without changing, in fact, valence angles and bond length, right? And so this is, in fact, one way to describe tripeptides. And in fact, if we consider the three C-alpha carbons in a tripeptide, in fact, it means that we have six dihedral angles to move. And in doing so, of course, I'm implicitly assuming that the omega angles, which are associated with the peptide bonds, are rigid, right? Which is, in fact, the case in nature, or if they can move. This is by tiny angular amounts as opposed to those the angles associated to C alpha carbons. So this is a basic tripeptide. And of course, there is a more general model where the three C alpha carbons are not consecutives, but I can have gaps between them. Right? And now if you go to the database of protein structures, meaning the protein data bank, if you collect tripeptides along all high resolution structures, once some redundancy has been filtered out using sequence homology, there is on the order of 3 million of tripeptides in high resolution loop structures, which is quite a lot of information. So why are tripeptides interesting to deform or to predict conformational changes of proteins? Because there is in fact a non-trivial theorem from in fact algebra, which I'm going to try to specify in simple words. So again, we are playing this game where we can change dihedral angles without changing valence angles and bond length. And now if I allow myself to change exactly six dihedral angles within a tripeptide, it turns out that the set of solutions, the set of conformations of the backbone where the six dihedral angles are free to move, to change, but all the remaining internal coordinates are fixed, the set of solution is discrete, meaning finite, and there are at most 16 solutions. So the derivation of the theorem has been a quest. It took like 20 years in robotics, in theoretical kinematics and biology. So it's a non-trivial calculation. And in fact, you have two illustrations. So these are the two illustrations we have seen on the first slide. So on the left-hand side, we have solved this degree 16 polynomial, and we ended up with seven roots. And as you can see, we have seven conformations for the backbone. And as I told you, the atoms which are in the middle, they are moving quite a lot. And so on the right-hand side, we have solved for all conformations of a CDR using C alpha carbons, which are found near the beginning and the end of the CDR on an antibody, an IgG, exactly here. And as you can see, we are generating diverse conformations. So in fact, I'm not going to bother you with technicalities, but in fact, solving this degree 16 polynomial is numerically challenging. There are numerical instabilities, but what might be of interest to you is in fact, the biophysical relevance of the conformations we are obtaining. And of course, we are going to study these conformations in Ramakanthan space, right? And so the first thing maybe to observe before discussing the energetics, in fact, is to observe that if I'm taking these 3 million of tripeptide in the protein data bank, for each of them, of course, I have a conformation of the tripeptide, but I can, of course, forget the six dihedral angles and solve for all conformations using the theorem I mentioned. And if I do so, I'm going to obtain for each data tripeptide up to 16 solutions. And in fact, it turns out that the number of solutions, you have a histogram here, which in fact lists the number of solutions up to 12. In fact, the maximum number of solutions we have observed for a loop in the PDB is 12 alternative geometries. But as you can see, the number of solutions correlates with the distance between the endpoints of the amino acids found to the left and to the right of the tripeptide. Why? Because of course, if we are looking at a tripeptide which is completely stretched, in fact, in order to bridge the gap, you hardly have any option. You have to go straight, right? On the other hand, if you're looking into a hairpin, of course, it's going to be much easier to, by rotational symmetry, to find geometries which are compatible. And so we have studied these properties. And what you have on the right-hand side, you have a movement of the atoms which are moving when we are studying all solutions. And as you can see, it turns out it's not very difficult to see, but trust me on that. There are five atoms which are moving, in fact. So this carbon, this nitrogen, this C-alpha, this carbon, this nitrogen, this C-alpha. We're stopping at N3. And as you can see here, we have violin plots showing the magnitude of the variation of the atoms, and it goes up to 6 centrums, right, for the middle atoms. And this is what I was saying earlier. In fact, when we are looking into alternative geometries given by TLC, in fact, we are really dealing with conformational changes which are highly diverse. And now, if we look, what we can do, of course, is to compare the Ramachandran diagrams of the data, what nature does and what we see in crystal structures or in NMR structures or in cryo-electron microscopy structures. And we can, of course, compare that against the distribution of phi and psi angles, which are observed in solutions of TLC, right? And as you can see here, it's very interesting because while nature essentially populates the classical regions of Ramachandran, as we have discussed earlier, when we are looking into solutions, it turns out that we have a much more homogeneous distribution, meaning that, in fact, solutions, except this big void in the middle, solutions of TLC are populating essentially the entire Ramachandran diagram, except the middle, of course, which also means that solutions are interpolating between what we see in crystal structures, right? Again, if you take a crystal structure, you are going to see in loops alpha right, alpha left helices, or beta sheets, beta proline regions. But in fact, one should keep in mind that in crystal structure, we see metastable states, right? States which are stable on long time scales if we are thinking in terms of thermodynamics. Here we are looking at geometric solutions, and they are less stable, of course, as we're going to see, but they are exploring much more exhaustively the conformational space of phi and psi angles. And of course, if we need also to take a look into the energetics, and in order to do this, we have to compare the energetics of a reconstruction by TLC against the energetics of, in fact, a reference structure in the protein data bank. So I'm not going to step into the technicalities, but let me try to convey the main message by looking at the plots. And so here we are studying, in fact, three types of energetics: the energetics associated with dihedral angles, the energetics associated with electrostatic interactions, and the energetics right-hand column associated with van der Waals interactions. And so the numbers are a bit small. I apologize for that. They are in kcal per mole. And in fact, they are small, which shows that less than 1 kcal per mole, or of course, 1 kcal per mole or 1.4 kcal per mole is already significant as a delta G. But still, these are what we are looking at here are small numbers, meaning that in solutions of TLC, the atoms are not stepping onto one another. We are generating conformations, as I said, which are quite homogeneous across space, but which in terms of energetics are really reasonable. And so this is in fact showing the strength of TLC in exploring the conformational space of backbone geometries. So if you want to take a look and to test such reconstructions, we have delivered. So this is a paper what I just mentioned, which is under now minor revision. So I hope it will be out soon. And so we also already distribute the source code in order to run these calculations. So of course, if we are talking about move sets of proteins, we have not solved the problem because so far I've just dealt with, in fact, tripeptides. So now I'm going to show you a couple of slides to go one step beyond and to solve to make a significant step towards solving the problem of move sets. And so, in fact, so this is a research domain in itself. And so many papers have been published. And so There are several approaches. So, of course, the classical thing is to look at molecular dynamics, etc., and make tiny moves for all atoms, but this is not really effective to predict large amplitude conformational changes. There are methods which are working on so-called constrained manifolds to respect some constraints on internal coordinates. They are not really effective either. And there is an interesting class of methods which are based upon tripeptides, because as I said, as we have seen, so if you have a set of solutions for, let's say, two consecutive tripeptides, maybe five solutions for the first one and 10 solutions for the second one. So it means that by taking the Cartesian product of these two sets, you have 50 solutions for this ensemble. And in fact, when one is using the strategy by gluing together conformation of tripeptides to build conformations of a loop, there is a problem, because I'm not going to discuss the details, but this is yielding a bias with a better samplings for the, those degrees of freedom which are found near the endpoints of the loop. Okay. And so what we have tried to do is to go beyond the state of the art and to propose a move set which is really trained to exploit and to model a loop as a whole, meaning without putting too much emphasis on the endpoints and by processing all amino acids in the loop on an equal footing, right? But for this, we had to develop some a non-trivial mathematical model for the geometric space of the entire loop, right? And then, so this is a space, of course, which lives in a high-dimensional space. In fact, if we have a tripeptide with a loop with m tripeptides, essentially, we are the parametric space of the whole loop is of dimension 6m, right? So if for example, you have a loop of dimension, let's say, 15, it means that you have five tripeptides, and in turn, so we are going to carry out, develop a model or a sampling of the loop in dimension 30. And so, as you can see, we have reduced drastically the dimensionality of the problem by focusing on tripeptides. And so, we are in this 6M dimensional space, we are defining constraints to restrict everything, to restrict the conformational space to valid geometries. And then we have to sample this region in high dimensional space, which is bounded by curved walls. And so these walls are defined by polynomial functions, also involving trigonometric functions. And so it's not a simple endeavor, but there are some interesting techniques using sophisticated machinery to do this. And so here I'm just showing an illustration where of, in fact, the random uniform random sampling of conformations of a loop of involving 15 amino acids. So this is a piece of work which is now almost ready to be submitted, but it's technically a bit challenging. So to conclude, what I tried to cover here today are two things. So first of all, I hopefully convince you that looking into tripeptides is in fact very interesting, because it makes it possible to enumerate discrete sets of conformations which are highly diverse and which avoid in fact the trap of tiny movements, right? And this is made possible by focusing on dihedral angles which are soft internal coordinates, or at any rate much softer internal coordinates than bond length or valence angles. So dealing with tripeptides is numerically challenging. So this is a problem I did not really discuss. And interestingly, so we have seen by looking into the statistics into Ramachandran space that this makes it possible to go beyond metastable states we see in crystal structures, right? And so now what we're doing, we are integrating these TLC-based reconstructions into the exploration of wall backbone geometry with two applications. The first one is to find low potential energy structures. So this, of course, would be very relevant, for example, to study the geometries of the entered domain of FMRPs, the problem Carol mentioned. And so hopefully we'll be able at some point to help Carol on this. And of course, the second application will deal not with structures, but with thermodynamics. In particular, what we would like to do is to be able to improve the prediction of binding affinities, for example, for antibodies against their antigens, but also for any protein interaction, right? And so this requires computing the density of states, partition functions, and so here we are in the realm of thermodynamics, right? And of course, equipped with the ability to make better structural predictions and also better thermodynamic predictions, so we could have countless applications in biology. So I hope in a few years, so 2, 3, maybe we'll be there. Okay, so these are the two papers. So the first one under revision, you can find it on the website of the group, and the second one will be out soon. Okay, I think I'm done. And so thank you for attention, and thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Frédéric. Any question? Maybe Carole?
Yeah, I hope this wasn't too far from biology. So we are dealing with proteins, but at different scales, as you can see, right? So
maybe I was wondering what was the part of the work of Timothy?
Excuse me, I didn't get the beginning of the question. What was the
contribution of Timothée?
Timothée, the PhD thesis of Timothée will have, three chapters. And so Timothée has worked on the investigation of properties of TLC, and so has also worked on the development of the geometric model of move sets exploiting TLC, right? And so in fact, in my group, so what we had done in the past were essentially static models of protein interfaces, of protein complexes. And so with Carole and a few other collaborators, Isabelle Musveto and the colleagues at INRA from INRA, Julien Josas working on antibodies, it clearly appeared like a few years back, 5 years back, that we have to move to dynamics, right? And so Timothy has been my second PhD student working on dynamics.
Okay, I see. And about fMRP, the protein of Carole. Mm-hmm. So, what is the problem that you have that you? Yeah.
Yeah. So the problem, in fact, so Timothy's master internship has been dedicated to the prediction of the structure of the enter domain, mm-hmm. its oligomeric status, dimer, trimer, etc. And in mm-hmm. fact, so for this problem, there were experiments, in particular Sachs curve, small angle X-ray scattering curves. And so a number of models had been published along with these experimental data. But in fact, these models were contradicting or were not coherent with the Sachs curves. And so in fact, we used a number of classical bioinformatics tools in order to enhance this model, promote the diversity of conformations of fMRP, the enter domain. And in fact, we didn't get anywhere, because in fact, when simulating Sachs curves using this ensemble of conformations, we didn't have anything coherent with, in fact, the Sachs curves, showing that the models were, in fact, were short from providing a satisfactory explanation of the in fact, biophysical properties of the protein in solution, right? And so we had to, but this is a more general problem, right? Because when we are talking about these complicated proteins which undergo very large conformational changes, predicting such changes is, as of today, it's an open problem, right? And so, and so people had used molecular dynamics, etc., namely tools which are making tiny time steps, and so this is not sufficient.
Okay. Can I ask a question, Frédéric? In fact, so you've shown us how you finally focused on small parts, I mean atoms, then you integrate with other tools on bigger part of the protein. So yes. what would be the limitation in size of the protein you could analyze?
Yeah. This is a good question. So as of today,
On t'entend plus.
You turned off your
microphone when Carole was speaking. The microphone automatically. So this is artificial intelligence, right? I'm not speaking. The microphone switches off automatically.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So,
we can't hear you. I don't know why.
Because the microphone is switching off automatic.
So stay like this when you talk.
So yes, the maximum state-of-the-art method quite limited for 15, limited at 15 amino acids. And so I hope much larger, in fact, loops, maybe twice as much. Right? But for this, we have to sample these complicated curved surfaces in high dimension. And so we are currently processing all the data sets which have been used in these papers. So it's we are producing the results. So we'll know soon.
thank both of you for your talks, and thank you all for attending. And I give you a rendezvous on the 6th Academy for Research webinar on the 16th of November. I hope we will be able to do it not on video, but on live presentations. So thank you very much again, Carole and Frédéric, and see you soon. Bye-bye.
Thank you to all of you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.